So now I am on slide number 2, and the title for this slide is Computer Architecture, a very fast recap. So as we had discussed in the last lecture, it is the operating system which is, you know, having a very heavy interaction with the various hardware components. So if you saw if you recall the various layers we had, the bottom layer was the hardware, and then we had the operating system, and then we had various user applications, user programs, and then finally the users. So because the operating system is the one is a software module which interacts very heavily with the hardware, therefore it would be good to have a very quick, very fast recap of computer organization and architecture. So essentially, what are the different parts of a computer? What exactly do they do, and how do they interact with each other in order to execute user programs? Okay. So having this recap would be nice, because we'll be referring to these terms again and again throughout the book. So of course, you would already be knowing about all of these, so this will be sort of a refresher for you, since you have already taken computer architecture. So first question is, what are the major components of a computer? So we know the answer to that. You've got your CPU, central processing unit, also called a processor. So on modern machines, we have many of these, right? Other major component is memory. So here we have, you know, both main memory, which we also call RAM, random access memory. And we can have other kinds of memory as well. Hard disk is an important one. And then we can have, tertiary or third level memory as well. For example, you have your USB drives. Right, so different kinds of memory technologies are there. Input-output components. Input-output, we'll abbreviate that to call it I/O. So I/O components, for example, our monitor, our keyboard, our mouse, our pen, right? When we're using something like a tablet, right? So these are the major components. What is the main objective of a computer? Of course, we know main goal is to execute user programs, right? So what will happen is that, you know, we have a bunch of applications, right, that we have downloaded, right? And each application consists of code, right? It's a piece of software. So it has that code, it has those instructions. So when we are executing a user program or an application, it means that the instructions of that program or application are being executed. Now, who executes these instructions? We know it is a CPU, and we can have many kinds of instructions. We can have a load, right, in which we are bringing instructions and data from the memory. We can have store, in which we are doing the reverse, right? And then we can have different arithmetic operations, and so on and so forth. So it is a CPU's job to execute those program instructions. What's the goal of memory? Of course, to store data in programs. So by default, everything will be stored in the disk. And then whenever we want to enable an application, and we double click it, then it moves from disk to memory, and then it executes. Finally, we have our I/O modules, which move data between the computer and the external environment, right? So we have input devices like our mouse and keyboard, and we have output devices like our monitor, right? So moving data between the computer and the external environment. So as such, these are the main components of a computer, and these are the main objectives of a or rather the main objective of a computer. Okay, so now I am on slide 3, which is titled Computer Components. So slide number 3, Computer Components. So you might have seen this picture in some form or the other. So this is a top level view of the various components of a computer. So you can see central to a computer is definitely the central processing unit, and within that you see various modules, right? You see a program counter, right? Instruction register, memory address register, memory buffer register, and then IO address and buffer registers, right? So one of the processor's main functions is to exchange data with memory, right? So you have some data or instructions in memory, you would like to bring them in to the CPU. Why? So that you can you can execute them, and then you may also want to do the reverse. That means transfer data from the CPU back to the memory. So once, let's say you've done a computation, for example an addition of two numbers, then that data needs to be written back to the memory as well, right? So that it can be it can be appropriately taken care of, right? So therefore we need some mechanism for exchanging data between CPU and memory. So for this purpose, CPU has two internal registers. One is memory address register. So memory address register will specify the address in memory for the next read or write. Okay, so it will contain the memory address for the next read or write. So based on the content, it will go to that location in memory and then accordingly do the read or write. What is this MBR? So memory buffer register. This contains the data to be written into memory or receives the data read from memory. Right. So one register is for the address, so you know where to go, and the other is for the contents. So for the memory buffer register, it's used to store the contents. So there may be a piece of data that you want to grab from memory to the CPU, or there may be a piece of data which you want to transfer the reverse from CPU to memory. Right. So that data is stored in the memory buffer register. So as you can see, we have a bi-directional, communication between the CPU and memory. You probably know that. Similarly, you have a pair of registers for I/O as well. Input-output register specifying a particular, I/O device, the address, right? And then you have an I/O buffer register used for exchanging data between the processor and an I/O module. So what we see from the picture is that you can have a communication between the CPU and main memory, and between the CPU and I/O. Right? So for example, if you want to display something to the monitor, so you have communication between CPU and main memory and I/O as well. So accordingly, you have registers for that. One register for tells you the next address, and another is for the actual data. Okay, so I think these are the modules. Then you have a program counter, which tells you the address of the next instruction to execute. So whenever your program has a set of instructions, and the CPU executes each and every one of them, and at any point of time the CPU needs to know which is the next instruction it has to go to. So that address is stored in the program counter. So maybe you're doing sequential execution, in which you go, let's say 100 address and 104 address, right? And then 108 address if you're working with ints, right? So like that, you have, and then you have an execution unit for executing the instructions, doing arithmetic and so on and so forth. So once again, we won't go too much in depth into each of these because they are part of the architecture. So probably already know about them, and it's outside the scope of this course. Here we are going to be spending most of the time learning about operating systems. So within the I/O module, you see buffers. So buffers is just a bunch of memory which you can use to store intermediate data. So while a user may input data at a very slow rate, much slower than the CPU can read from it. So therefore, just to sort of do some kind of synchronization among CPU and I/O module, whatever data the user is inputting, you can store it in buffers, and then the CPU can just read from there. So memory module we see consists of set of memory locations defined by sequentially numbered addresses. So you probably know that from intro to programming and architecture. Each location contains a bit pattern that can be represented either as an instruction or data. As you can see, in main memory you can store instruction as well as data. Each of the memory locations has an address. So IO module transfers data from external devices to processor and memory, and it contains internal buffers for temporarily storing data until that can be sent further. So I think with this you should have a good revision of various computer components. Okay, so now I am on slide 4, and this again you would definitely have seen this picture. This is an instruction cycle. So we know that any program that needs to be executed has a series of instructions, right? So you may have done programming in that, assembly programming. So you've got a set of instructions stored in memory, right? So now what is the execution cycle for one particular instruction, right? So of course first is the fetch phase, in which you fetch the next instruction from memory, right? And then once you fetch it, then of course you execute that instruction, right? So first you have a fetch phase, and then you have an execution phase, and then this repeats. So you execute one instruction at a time, you go sequentially, unless you have to do some repetitive computation, or unless you have to loop, or get out of that sequential mode and go to some other memory location. So fetch, execute. That generally is how an instruction is executed. Right. So the fetch instruction, the instruction that you fetch, next one, is loaded into the instruction register. If you go to the previous slide, one register which the CPU had was IR, instruction register. So that is meant for storing the next instruction which you are executing. Yeah, so then CPU looks there, and then it knows this is the instruction which needs to be executed, perhaps doing a load or store or adding numbers. So this as such is the instruction cycle, and as we already talked about, the program counter holds the address of the next instruction to be fetched. So next instruction to be fetched, the address of that is stored in the program counter, and the actual instruction, right, is loaded into the instruction register, right? Okay, so now I am on slide 5. So as we know, internally each each instruction or each piece of data is represented internally in binary format. You have a particular size. So here we see the instruction components, right? So we have two kinds. The first, we have a format for an instruction, and the second, we have format for a data. So yeah, both instructions and data, right? And for both of them we are storing them in 16 bits, right? Now, of course, modern machines are they have 32 bit and 64 bit as well, right? So if you look at part A, it shows the instruction format, 16 bits, out of which 4 bits are reserved for the opcode. So the opcode, what is the use of that? You may already know. The opcode tells us what kind of instruction it is, right? So we have various categories of instructions, and for each we have a different opcode. So part D in this slide shows the some partial list of opcodes, right? A partial list of opcodes. One is for loading accumulator from memory. So AC is your accumulator register for temporary storage, right? Data register, the accumulator. So load the accumulator from memory, right? So probably get some data from memory and load it into the accumulator. 10, store accumulator to memory. So take the contents of accumulator and store them in memory. So you can see that you have load and store communication happening, or accesses happening both ways, from memory to CPU. So the AC is in CPU, and from CP2 to memory. 101 add to accumulator from memory. So in the next slide we'll look at some examples. So main point over here is 4 bits are reserved for the opcode, and you can, you know, depending on the kind of instruction you're looking at, load, store, add or something else, they will all have a different opcode. So looking at the first 4 bits, the CPU can determine what kind of instruction it is. Rest of the, you know, so 16 minus 4, rest of the 12 bits, so they are for the remaining bits for the instruction. So perhaps, you know, it will contain, you know, the address of the register, you know, where you need to go to and other things. B shows the integer format. So 15, you know, probably 15 bits for the magnitude, and S would, I think, be for the sign, one bit for the sign, positive, negative. Right? So this shows us that internally how is an instruction represented. Okay, so I hope it is clear. Okay, so now I am on slide 6, titled Program Execution. So what we'll do is very quickly, we will go through one sample computation, see the instruction and instructions involved and see how they execute, right? So example of program execution, contents of memory and registers, right? So what exactly do we want to do here, right? The goal is to add contents of memory word at address 940 to the contents of memory word at address 941 and store the results in the latter location. So if you look at step one, memory location 940, what do we have? We have 3. At 941, what do we have? We have 2. So we want to do 3 plus 2, which is 5, and then store 5 in 941 location. Okay, so that's the idea. Okay. So here now, in order to do this, we'll need 3 instructions. So which means each of them will have their own fetch and execute stages. So that is, you know, those 3 instructions are what we will need, right? So you can see step one, and you've got memory, you've got CP registers. PC, remember, contains the the next location which we need to go to. AC is the accumulator register, and IR is the instruction register containing the address of the next instruction, which we have to execute, right? So PC will hold the address. So once again, to clarify between PC and IR, PC will hold the address of the next instruction to be fetched, right? And IR will, the fetched instruction is loaded into the IR, okay? So this is how it is going to work. And now let's see. So I can see what's going on. PC contains 300, right, which is the address of the first instruction. So we go to 300 and then we pull the next instruction, which is 1940. Okay. And of course we load that into IR, because the instruction has to be loaded into IR register. So now IR, that's step one. IR now contains 1940, and now we have to execute this, of course. So first 4 bits give us 1, which we look at our previous chart. It tells us to load AC register from memory. And the rest of it is, 940. Okay. So first 4 bits specify, indicate that this, what is the instruction type? AC to be loaded from memory. Remaining 12 bits specify the memory address, which is 940, right? So it's 1940. So we go to 940 and we have our first piece of data 3, and then we have to load that to the AC. So which is what we do in step 2. We go to 940, take 3 and load it into our AC accumulator register, right? So that was what the instruction was, AC to be loaded from location 940. So that is done. So now what will the PC contain? It contains the next memory location of the next instruction to be executed. So So automatically we increment from 300 to 301. So now what do? 301 we go to and fetch the next instruction 5941 and copy to the instruction register. Now 5941, first 4 bits 5, which means add to AC from memory. And rest of the 12 bits 941. So go to 941, take the contents at location 941 and add them to the accumulator. So take 2. Accumulator already has 3, 3 plus 2, 5, and put 5 there. No, that's step 4, right? Step 5, now what will the PC contain? Increment by 1, 302, right? So it's, you can see it's going sequentially. And 302, the instruction is 2941, right? So we just copy to the instruction register. And the first 4 bits, 2, tells us that store AC to memory, which means take the content of AC, store it to memory, and rest of the 12 bits 941, which means store it to location 941. So we go to we take the contents of the accumulator, which is 5, and then we store them in 941, because that's what we intended. The result has to be stored in location 941. So with this, I think hopefully you would have got a good recap, good revision of how exactly these instructions are executed using a program counter instruction register, and here we also use accumulator register. So PC, what does it do? It contains the memory address of the next instruction. So one by one we go sequentially, we visit sequential memory locations, grab the instructions and then copy them to the instruction register, and then we just execute them one at a time. Okay. So hope this is clear. Now I am on slide 7, example of program execution. So this just contains the series of steps that we have to take in order to execute those 3 instructions. So we already discussed this in slide number 6. So I've just put these in text, for your understanding. Okay, so you can go through them one at a time. Once again, the goal is to add contents of memory word. Right, the word here is what's the size of the word here? It's 16 bit. So add contents of memory word at address 940 to the contents of memory word at address 941, and store the results in the latter location, means at 941. So we have 3 instructions which we see, located at 300, 301, and 302. Right, so our instructions are located at 300, 301, and 302. Our data is located at 940 and 941. Okay. So I think with this example, the whole process of executing instructions, should be clear. Okay. Okay. So now I am on slide number 8, and the title for this slide is Computer System Organization. So as it shows in the picture given on the slide. Computer system consists of one or more CPUs. So typically these days we don't have one CPU, we always have multiple CPUs on the same machine. Device controllers connected through a common bus, providing access to shared memory. So we see that we have a bunch of devices. One example is a disk, right, for storage. And then we've got our I/O devices, our mouse, our keyboard, our printer, and then our monitor, right? And all of them, may have different kind of, interfaces to connect to the, computer. So for a monitor, maybe it has a graphical adapter or a specific kind of interface. And your printers, keyboards, mouse, they're all connected through USB interface. So bottom line is that each device that is associated with your computer has a device controller. So disk has a disk controller for mouse, keyboard, printer, USB controller, right, and so on, right? And all of them are sharing the memory. So here when we say memory, we mean main memory. So they are competing with each other for memory cycles. So the memory manager has to, you know, overall manage everything, has to synchronize everything so that, you know, accesses take place properly. Okay. And what it also says is concurrent execution of CPUs and devices. So, both the CPU as well as various kinds of devices that we have seen, they may execute at their own rates, right? So, some may be faster than the others. So, therefore, you know, we allow for concurrent execution. So, if the CPU is executing some instruction or, you know, running some application and then it dispatches some data to the printer, right, or it is waiting for some data to come from the keyboard, then, you know, while that data is coming, it can go on and, you know, execute other tasks, right, because the CPU, runs instructions extremely fast, whereas it might take a user, you know, maybe 2-3 seconds or even more to type in the data. So they're all running concurrently together at the same time. Now I am on slide 9. Title is device controllers. So in the previous slide, we saw that for each kind of device that's attached to the system, there is an associated device controller. Right. So what exactly does this device controller do? So first of all, this device controller is a piece of hardware. Okay. And its major job is to connect the operating system to the various devices. So, definitely the mouse has to be appropriately linked to the operating system, right? So that it can do its job. The keyboard has to be linked to the OS, printer has to be linked to the OS, right? You know, and so on. So device controller is a piece of hardware that connects the OS to various devices, right? Each device controller then is in charge of a particular device, right? Goal of a device controller is to make I/O data available to the OS, right? So if the the program is needs to read some input from the keyboard, then keyboard will have a device controller, and its job, the device controller for the keyboard, its job will be to make sure that the keyboard data is available to the OS, right? So probably, you know, it will have its own local buffer, its own chunk of memory. So as we type in the keystrokes, they will be recorded in the order in which they are typed in, first come first serve, and they will be stored in a buffer, and then the OS or whatever application is there, you know, can read it and then act accordingly, right? So controller may have its own local buffer to store data, right? For example, data read by keyboard is put in a buffer from where it can be read by the OS. So because a controller is a piece of hardware, it has some software that accomplishes its task, and then that software is called a device driver. Okay. So device driver is a software that manages the device or the hardware controllers. So we have two terms here. One is a device controller, which is a piece of hardware that connects the appropriate device to the OS. Its goal is to make the input-output data available to the OS, right? So that is a device controller, piece of hardware. And to do its, in order to do its job, each device controller has a device driver. So that's a piece of code that accomplishes its job. Okay. Now I am on slide 10, which is titled interrupts. So you may have heard about this term, an interrupt. So simply put, it's something which alerts the CPU to an event which requires the CPU's attention. So an interrupt is something which alerts the CPU to an event which requires the CPU's attention. Okay. So as it says on the first bullet point, how does a device driver inform the CPU that it has finished its operation? So let's say CPU is executing some program code, and then as we discussed, as part of that, it has to wait for some input from the user's keyboard. So once that wait signal is given, then the CPU goes off and starts executing some other job, some other program. So now eventually the device driver in that keyboard device controller kicks in, executes the code, and eventually that keyboard data is now available to the OS to read, right? So now question is, how will the device driver inform the CPU that it has finished its operation, so that the CPU can resume, it can pick up that data from the keyboard and resume the execution of the interrupted program or the aborted program. So it the device driver does that by causing an interrupt. Okay. So an OS is heavily interrupt driven, and events in an OS are signaled by interrupts. So there are different kinds of interrupts for different events, which we will soon see. Interrupts to an OS may be signaled either by hardware or by software. So when they are signaled by hardware, generally the hardware will interrupt the CPU by sending a signal across the system bus. Okay, so bus will be used for communication. Right? So, I hope you would have learned this in organization, system bus. So hardware interrupts the CPU by sending a signal, right? And then the CPU has to process that interrupt accordingly. Software interrupts CPU by executing what we call know as a system call. So piece of code, system call. So we're going to be looking at system calls a lot in this course. So for now, we should know that using an interrupt, the CPU can be informed that there is an event that requires its assistance. So in other words, the CPU is interrupted, and interrupts can be caused through the hardware or through the software. Okay. So an operating system is interrupt driven, definitely. This is how, for example, the CPU gets to know about a program that wants to start execution. So CPU might be already juggling 4 or 5 programs, and then whenever you want to run the 6th program, how will the CPU come to know about it? It will get an interrupt that hey, you have to run the 6th program, and then it may schedule that also. So many other events besides this are signaled by interrupts, as we shall soon see. Okay. I hope this interrupt concept is clear, right? So now I am on slide 11, interrupt timeline. Right. So here we see that 2 different interrupts are generated, and the CPU needs to handle them. So top line shows is for the CPU, bottom line signal is for the IO devices. Okay, so what is happening is CPU, the top line is means that some user program is running for the CPU, and the bottom line means CPU is processing the interrupt, right? Likewise for IO device, top line means it's idle, bottom line means it's transferring data, right? So it will transfer data using its buffer, and then the CPU and the OS is ready to read it. So it shows that initially, CPU is executing user programs, right? And then below it shows the IO is idle for some time. And then there is some IO request, right? So probably something was typed into the keyboard, or probably some mouse gesture was made, right? Probably for a smartphone, some touch gesture was made. So there's an IO request. And once the IO request, IO device, its state changes from idle to transferring. So what is it transferring? Now data is being transferred. It will take some time, right? So if you're typing in some, keyboard keys. So once that transfer is finished, transfer done. Now IO device goes back to idle state. And now, once the transfer is done, now the interrupt is signaled. So now you've typed in whatever you needed to in the keyboard, like let's say web address, for example, google.com. And now once you've typed that in, now is the time to signal the interrupt to the CPU, right? So the CPU, accepts that interrupt, right? So when the CPU is interrupted, it stops what it is doing and immediately transfers execution to a fixed location. So fixed location usually contains starting address where the interrupt service routine is located, and it executes that code and processes that interrupt accordingly. So, right, so we signal an interrupt, right? And the CPU spends some time to process that interrupt, which is the lower line you see in the CPU, for the CPU. And then once the interrupt has been handled, it has processed that interrupt, then it can go back and start its user program execution. So, and then again that same event again happens after a while. So then for some time, CPU is executing user programs, IO device is idle. Then another IO request is made. So the IO device is now in a running state, right? And some data is transferred, right? And then once a data transfer is done, then an interrupt is generated for the CPU. And CPU takes some time, it stops what it is doing, and now it has to dedicate its resources to processing this interrupt. There again some instructions. So it executes an interrupt service routine, processes this particular interrupt, and then once the interrupt has been handled, it has been processed, it goes back to running the user program. So this just shows a timeline of how interrupts are handled, right? So now I am on slide 12, and this just describes in words the picture of the previous slide. Right, so slide number 12, interrupt timeline. So here's a sequence of events. CPU is busy executing some instructions of a program, right? So straight line. Then the CPU is interrupted. CPU stops its execution and transfers its control to a fixed location in memory that contains the ISR, interrupt service routine. So it shows that the interrupt is interrupt processing is going on in the CPU part of it. So this routine code, ISR code is executed, interrupt service routine code. On completion, CPU resumes execution of interrupted program. The program it was executing before it was interrupted to take care of this interrupt, right? So a table of pointers here is maintained. Each pointer points to specific interrupt service routine. So then what you have is you have a simple table data structure. And for each kind of interrupt that you can have, you have the corresponding interrupt service routine. So obviously each interrupt can be signaling different kind of events, right? So an input interrupt is different from an output interrupt and so on. So therefore you have a table, and for each interrupt you have a particular interrupt service routine. So table of pointers. And each pointer points to specific interrupt service routine. Okay. So this table of pointers is stored in low memory location. So like whenever we start naming memory locations, we can start from 0 and then 1, 2, 3, 4 going all the way to whatever the maximum size is, depending on how much memory we have available with us. And generally this table of pointers is stored in those low memory locations. So this data structure is called an interrupt vector. Say star IV 100, so which means it's got 100 pointers, each pointing to interrupt service routines. So in your C programming language, you might have probably would have studied an array of pointers. So that is what this data structure is, right? Interrupt vector. So the definition of vector is to direct to a desired point, which is what it does. So both Windows and Linux service interrupts in exactly this manner. Okay, so here I am on slide 13, interrupt implementation. Okay. So we discuss a bit more about these interrupts, how they are implemented, continuing from the last slide. So CPU hardware has a wire called an interrupt request line, right, that it senses after executing every instruction. So there's a wire, right, interrupt request line that is sensed by the CPU after it executes every instruction, right? So whenever a device controller generates an interrupt for the CPU, it will send a signal down that line, right? So when the CPU detects a device controller has sent a signal, so it will, one of the things which will be passed is an interrupt number. Right, and based on the number, it jumps to the relevant interrupt service routine. Right, so it was an array of pointers. So the index of that array will give us the will tell us which interrupt service routine we have to jump to. So CPU executes interrupt service routine code to service interrupt. So note that when the CPU is servicing that particular interrupt code, then whatever it was doing, that has to be kept track of. So the state has to be saved, current state of CPU, which memory location it was on, what instruction it was executing, right? Was the instruction completed, right? So that you remember the state, and then you can restore it later. So after servicing the interrupt, CPU goes back to what it was doing, and that means executing the next instruction of the halted program. And of course, you have to do a state restore for this, load back the next memory location, put it in program counter, and continue execution. Right. In modern operating systems, interrupts are assigned a priority level. Right. So some interrupts may be more critical than the others. So therefore, you can have what we call as a priority levels. So if an interrupt is of utmost priority, it gets the highest priority level, right? So maybe some virus is detected or some security threat is detected. In that case, those can be assigned as a highest priority level. Okay. So some interrupt codes, vector number 0 is a divide error, right? So let's say dividing by 0. Vector number 6, invalid opcode, right? So we discussed that each instruction has an associated opcode. In our example, it was comprised of 4 bits. So if the opcode is invalid, so for example, if you want to add and whatever the opcode for add instruction is, you type in something else. So that that will cause an interrupt. Number 7, device is not available, right? Number 14, page fault. You are requesting a particular part of the program or data, and it is not in the main memory, which means you have to fetch it from disk. So you have what is called a page fault, and you have to go to disk and fetch it. So these integers here are indexes to the array of pointers. So now I'm on slide 14. So this just shows us the interrupt IO cycle. So what we have been discussing all along, it's just made a flowchart of that, right? So you have two entities executing. One is a CPU and one is your IO device controller, right? So the events are given in sequence. Device driver initiates IO, right? Now IO initiated, and then input ready, output complete, or error generates interrupt signal, right? So while generating the interrupt, some data is probably to be read, and once that data is read, then the interrupt signal is generated to the CPU, right? Or it may be an error, some kind of error, so that information is also passed along. So CPU receives the interrupt, transfers control to the appropriate interrupt handler based on that vector code. Right. Interrupt handler processes that data, the piece of code associated with each interrupt, returns from interrupt, and CPU resumes processing of interrupted task. And in between instructions, the CPU keeps on checking for whether there are any interrupts or not by listening to that interrupt request line. So I hope now the whole interrupt cycle is clear. Right. So now I am on slide 15. So as we had discussed, we can have different kinds of interrupts. So just to give you some sense of what those can be, here we have various categories of interrupts. So program interrupts, timer interrupts, IO interrupts, hardware failure interrupts, right? So program interrupts as a result of instruction execution, right? So for example, if you have arithmetic overflow, right? So if your register is only capable of handling a 16-bit number, and you supply it with 32 bits, what's going to happen? You have an overflow, right? So then your hardware has to handle it appropriately, right? Out of bounds instruction, so trying to access some piece of memory which you are not supposed to access, so that will generate an interrupt. Generally, maybe that is not allowed. By default, programs are not allowed to poke into or look into each other's block of assigned memory locations. So that you know, once that happens, then we'll look at more details in the chapter on memory management. But once that is detected, that a program is trying to access an address space of some other program, then an interrupt is generated for out of bounds, right? So eventually CPU will handle it. The timer interrupts generated by timer in the processor to perform functions at regular intervals, right? IO interrupts, right? So like we talked about for that keyboard and all, normal IO completion or error conditions, if the data maybe could not be read. Hardware failure interrupts, power failure, right? So this just tells us we can have, you know, different categories of interrupts. These are just four categories. There are, you know, a lot more are available, right? So types of interrupts. Okay, so now I am on slide 16, and the title is interrupt vector table. Right? So this is the last slide on interrupts. So here we have taken an sample interrupt vector table. So as we discussed, what does this contain? So it's got a bunch of memory addresses, and for each interrupt, and then starting address for each interrupt, and also an index, right? We talked about index for the array of pointers, right? So here you can see various interrupts, you know, divide error, single step, overflow, which we talked about, undefined opcode, right, and some other ones also, page faults protection, coprocessor error. So here we see, you know, we see information for the table contains information for 17 interrupts, and as we mentioned, they are located in lower memory locations, this interrupt vector table. So going from 000 to 4, so these are all in hexadecimal, right? So I think probably you can see 4 bytes for one, right? So 048 and going like that. So this is an example of a real life interrupt vector table. Okay. So there are 256, shows 256 4 byte entries, 32 bit entries. Right. And then how they're divided, it's all given.